McCarthy will not seek the speakership again. Now, sources telling me at this hour, some House Republicans have been in contact with and have started an effort to draft former President Donald Trump to be the next speaker. And I have been told that President Trump might be open to helping the Republican Party, at least in the short term, if necessary.
Just absolute clown show this country has become. I should say our politicians have become. Now that Kevin McCarthy has been ousted from his speakership role, far-right House Republicans are calling on Trump to serve as the interim speaker. Now, what does Trump think about that? Reporters caught up with him on the third day of his financial fraud civil trial, and here's what he had to say. So Trump seems open to it, although he does note that they have some great, great people in the Republican Party who could fantastic serve people. That role. What do you think, Waz?
He said it himself, I'm leading by 50 points for the presidency. Yeah. I don't want this penny ante speakership crap on my desk. I'm sure he's obviously flattered by the idea that he would, you know, be the leader of some other branch of government for the Republicans. But it's obvious that he thinks speakership is beneath him.
He does think it's beneath him. And you're right, you look at the polling and right now, if the election were to take place, there's a good chance that Trump could even win in the general based on the average of polls that show Trump and Biden neck and neck, which is definitely concerning. But what about Jim Jordan, a Trump loyalist? What does he think about all this? Let's watch.
I don't know. He'd be great, but I want Donald Trump to be the next president of the United States. If he wants to be speaker,
well,
great.
Still, well, I want
him to be president of the United States.
He's still going to be running for president.
He's still gonna run for president. Don't worry, everybody. He's still gonna run for president. Now, interestingly enough, Jim Jordan seemed to be a little upset over what happened to Kevin McCarthy. I want to go to that video now.
I thought it was unfair to Kevin. Kevin, I think, has done a fine job, and he and I came in together. He's a good man, and he didn't deserve this, in my judgment.
Will you run for speaker?
That's a decision for the conference.
Now we have word that Jim Jordan has thrown his hat, his name into the hat, or the ring, I should say, to essentially become the next Speaker of the House. Axios's Andrew Solander caught up with Jordan on Wednesday, meaning today, who told him, yes, he will enter the running to be the next House Speaker. Jordan also said that he spoke to House Majority Leader Steve Scalise, another top candidate, who by the way is also in the running for this position, about the matter. And now he's investigating whether he can consolidate enough support to make it happen. And what he means by that is, will he be able to unite the so-called moderate wing of the Republican Party with the far right wing of the Republican Party? You know, those who are part of the so-called House Freedom Caucus in the House.
What a mess. I mean, this was pretty predictable. Once we read or we saw what the conditions for McCarthy's speakership were, when these Freedom Caucus terrorists, quite frankly, allowed him to ascend to the position. They said one person,
yep,
can bring up a vote to get him out of here. One congressman,
yep,
could do that. He neutered himself the second that he even took the job. And so what I would ask anybody who is a Republican and who cares about this, who is the person short of Donald Trump, literally, who would be allowed to do this job?
No,
I don't think that person even exists for real.
That's a great point. So Senator Mitch McConnell, the Senate Minority Leader, gave a word of advice to House Republicans. He argued, listen, whoever the next speaker ends up being, they need to ensure that they do away with that ability for one member of the party to file a motion to remove the speaker. And remember, before McCarthy agreed and agreed to that concession, basically what needed to happen is that the party, the majority of the party, had to vote to even bring up another vote where they can decide, you know, through a House vote, including everyone, whether or not this individual should be voted out of the speakership role. So McConnell's like, look, word of advice, why don't we go back to the old system? Because this is just gonna keep happening over and over again. Look, for my purposes, I don't care about any of this. And the reason why I don't care about any of this is because it's not even gonna matter who the House Speaker is. It is very clear to me that the relationship between the Democrats and Republicans was, I mean, it was already incredibly toxic, unworkable, untenable. They have less interest in actually delivering for the American people than, you know, engaging in their ridiculous catfights. But now there's fracturing even among the Republicans in the House. So look, this is just a way of saying they're not interested in doing anything for you. That should be concerning. It shows how broken Congress is. But whether it's freaking Jim Jordan or Kevin McCarthy, they're gonna look out for their donors. Even though Matt Gaetz, I just love this, Matt Gaetz loves the idea of Jim Jordan running for this position, right? So he supported him saying, my mentor Jim Jordan would be great. Now Matt Gaetz is also the same guy who pretends to be very concerned about corruption among our politicians. Interesting, okay, but Jim Jordan's different, I guess. So if you've forgotten who Jim Jordan is, let us remind you of why this man really has no business being Speaker of the House or a representative of any district in this country. So Richard Strauss, the former doctor for the Ohio State wrestling team, was accused of sexually abusing at least 177 male student patients between 1979 and 1998. Now you might be wondering, okay, why are you bringing that up in the context of this speakership story involving Jim Jordan? Well, because one wrestler, Tito Vasquez, says he still remembers the day 3 decades ago when the doctor he'd gone to see about a bloody nose insisted on examining his genitals. Now, he, along with several other wrestlers, had basically told Jim Jordan about it when he was the assistant coach, and Jim Jordan did nothing about it. In fact, it seems like he provided cover for this behavior. Vasquez also recalls how one of his coaches dismissed his immediate complaint. I have nothing to do with this, Vasquez quoted the assistant coach saying, as he effectively ended the conversation and went on with wrestling practice. The coach, Vasquez says, was Jim Jordan. Jordan has, of course, emphatically denied these allegations. He says that he knew nothing about Strauss's abuse during his own years working at Ohio State University between 1987 and 1995. His campaign turned to PR company Shirley and Bannister Public Affairs, which distributed statements on the matter and set up a website presenting support for Jordan. Jordan's campaign paid the firm about $95,000 in 2018, according to campaign finance records. But six former OSU wrestlers said that they were actually present when Jordan heard or responded to sexual misconduct complaints about Strauss. Eight others say Strauss's inappropriate behavior was an open secret in the athletic department and that Jordan, among others, must have known about it. In fact, here are the accounts of other OSU wrestlers.
Former OSU wrestler Dunyasha Yetz says Jordan is one of the coaches who knew because he told him. In January of 1993, Yetz went to see Strauss for a thumb sprain and the doctor tried to pull down his pants. Yetz says he kicked open the doctor's door to escape. Jordan was right outside next to an ice machine.
He jumped up like, what's going on? I said, coach, he just tried to give me a physical exam for my thumb injury. Look, it looked like a baseball, it swelled up. And he was like, man, if he ever tried that, I would kill him.
Jordan supporters say Yetz can't be trusted because of a past conviction for fraud. But two other wrestlers told CNN they witnessed the encounter.
I do recall somebody bringing up something to one of the assistant coaches And his response was simply, well, if he ever tried that with me, I'd snap his neck like a stick of dry balsa wood.
And I remember the exact phrase about, you know, if that happened to me, I'd break his neck.
The coach who talked about breaking Strauss's neck was Jim Jordan, according to both Richie and Flushy.
Richie also said this, when we heard Jim say he wasn't aware, everyone just thought, are you kidding? I like Jimmy, but I think he took the wrong stance off the get-go, and now he can't backtrack. And former OSU wrestler Adam DiSabato told Ohio State legislators that Jordan called him in 2018, okay, basically asking him to provide a counter narrative to testimony that his own brother gave in regard to the sexual abuse that Jim Jordan knew about. He's quoted as saying, Jim Jordan called me crying, groveling on the 4th of July, begging me to go against my brother, begging me, crying for a half hour. That's the kind of cover-ups that's going on here or there. So that's who Jim Jordan is. And that is who Matt Gaetz is propping up, which kind of makes sense considering some of the allegations against Matt Gaetz himself. But any final thoughts on this?
I mean, I can't be surprised that Jim Jordan would stick his neck out in service of covering his own hide instead of being brave. I don't think anybody should be surprised by that revelation. But yeah, his politics are obviously horrible. So obviously for those reasons alone, I don't think the guy should have sent to the speakership. But yeah, a guy with a past like that, honestly, it aligns with some of the things that these guys want nowadays in the GOP. It's kind of sad to see this go. And people wonder how we could have a way forward. It would take some bravery on this part of the people who aren't the crazies to relinquish power. And we've seen on both sides, might I add, that the idea that you would relinquish power for the betterment of the country and the party so that they could probably start from scratch with, like, you know, trying to build an actual political party rather than what we have now, which if you read some of the statements, they're like, the next speaker needs to investigate Hunter Biden and put impeachment of Joe Biden on it. These are the stakes.
I know, Anna. I know. That's why, look, this is the reason why it's hard for me to be at all invested in who the Republican Speaker of the House is gonna be, because the party actually is united on one thing, and it's to essentially deflect and distract from, you know, how they aid and abet corporate interests, how they push for tax cuts for the richest and corporations in the country. They want to deflect from all of that. They want to deflect from the fact that they're bought and sold. And so they just focus on the investigations. That is what they're united on. The next House Speaker, whoever the Republican ends up being, is not going to fight for you, is not going to work hard to ensure that we're passing laws that protect ordinary Americans. They're just gonna focus on nonsense that wastes more taxpayer money on nonsense investigations. I mean, they brought forth an impeachment inquiry into Biden without any evidence of wrongdoing. That is what they're about, and that is what they will continue to do, period.
Thanks for watching. If you become a member, you get to watch all this ad-free, except for, of course, this ad. Still, hit the join button below.